Thanks for leading us, guys. Welcome and good morning. I'm Jeremy, one of the pastors here at the Axis, and today is week four of Advent. And over the past 3 weeks of observing Advent together as a church family, we've adopted the narrative of the Old Testament. We've been led from Egypt, focusing on the Exodus. We've made our way through the wilderness, a season of waiting and trusting and losing heart. We've been guided by the prophets, a season of listening, of ignoring, and a season of silence. And again, a big thanks for a great job to pastors Brooks and Don and elder candidate Derek. It takes tremendous skill and knowledge to do what they've done over the last 3 weeks, preaching the Old Testament narrative without pressing too much into the gospel. For a Jesus-exalting, gospel-centered preacher and teacher, it is very difficult to do that. Really, really hard. But we've tried to do that in such a way as to create a longing, to embrace this tension that exists, a season for longing for the Messiah to arrive, awaiting his arrival. So Egypt, wilderness, prophets, and now for today, Messiah. As we considered Egypt, we know that we need to be saved from the captivity of Egypt. As we considered the wilderness, we ask ourselves, will we ever be saved? As we considered the prophets, we hear them say there is a way to be saved. And now today, as we consider the Messiah, we get to see one say, I've come to save you. In Egypt, we say that we're very desperate, that we're needy, that we need to be delivered, that we must be rescued. It can't stay this way. And in the wilderness, we think, well, God's way can't be right. There's got to be a better way. There's got to be a different way. Well, then God sends the prophets, and we tell the prophets, God's way is not right. And then the Messiah steps into human history, sent by God, and he says, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one escapes captivity except through me. No one gets out of the wilderness except through me. No one escapes the greater Egypt except through me. No one comes to the Father except through me. The gospel story tells us that we're all born in Egypt. We're all born as slaves, slaves to the ruthless and abusive masters, slave to sin and slaves to death. And we're working very hard to appease the world, the flesh, and the devil. And this is our natural drift. We're seeking peace, but we only find greater hostility. We desire rest, but we only grow more restless. We're needing relief, but we only receive more pain. And the reality is that through our lives, we're all looking for deliverance from Egypt, from our Egypt, from this separation, from this hostility, from this captivity. We're all looking for freedom. We're all looking for a deep-seated satisfaction. And this search for us plays out in a number of different ways, like religion, like rebellion, like riches, like relationships. And as we seek deliverance, wandering about from potential savior to potential savior, we find ourselves in a sort of wilderness. And this wilderness is often where we run from one hope to another, from one potential rescuer to another, from one possible way out to another. And we drift along, dreaming of a day that we're free from Egypt, dreaming of a day when we're delivered from the wanderings through the dry and weary wilderness, dreaming of when we're living a life that's full of meaning, that's full of purpose, that's full of peace, and that's full of fun and joy. But to think of meaning and purpose and peace and joy and happiness in the midst of the wilderness seems to be like trying to drink from a mirage, thinking it's water but consuming sand. The wilderness teaches us a very hard way. The wilderness teaches us what's not the way. And many of us in this room, we know what's not going to satisfy. Many of us in this room know where not to place hope. Most of us can speak for days about things that can disappoint us. But most of us don't know where to look for true help. Most of us, at best, need to be reminded of where true help comes from. Well, this is part of the role of the prophets. So Egypt, wilderness, and now prophets. This is one of the main roles of the prophets. The prophets were mouthpieces of God, speaking his message on his behalf. And their message offered hope, and it did offer a way out of Egypt, a way out of the wilderness. And the prophets told those needing deliverance, here's the way back home. The prophets would tell us, here's the route to hope. But thinking that we know a better way, we try, it seems, anything else except the way that the prophets were guiding us toward. Often it's difficult, often if it doesn't make sense to us, we naturally and instantly think, well, it's got to be wrong. It can't be right. And so we perpetuate the wilderness. And our wandering in the wilderness continues. Yet God continues to send prophets and mouthpieces and messengers saying, here's the way. If you'd listen to me, if you could obey, you would find the way. It doesn't have to be this way, nor does it have to stay this way. Yet, even when we would try really, really hard, we couldn't seem to be consistent enough or hold up our end of the bargain enough, our end of the covenant. And so we continue this drifting despair through this wilderness. And then in the midst of some of the most silent years in human history, out of nowhere, God loved the world that couldn't keep it together, the world that couldn't hold up their end of the bargain, the world that could not obey, that could never do the right thing in the right way. He loved that world, not an overly romanticized good world. He loved it so much that he gave his only son, so that whoever believes in this Christ, his son, would not perish, would not die in Egypt, would not die in the wilderness, would not remain in captivity, but would have eternal life. They would be delivered. For God did not send the Messiah, his son, into the world to further condemn the world, to lock them up even more. But in order that the world might be delivered and rescued, might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him, the Messiah, is not condemned. They are freed. Friends, this is the Messiah. Jesus is the Christ, the promised deliverer, the one who is taking captive captivity, and the one who frees us from captivity. This is the Messiah, Jesus, who brings about the greater exodus, delivering us from sin and suffering and death. The Messiah who will willingly enter the wilderness, experiencing temptation and great loss, yet without sin, never once not obeying his Father perfectly. This is the Messiah who makes good on all the promises of God. He's the fulfillment of all the prophets and covenants. This is the Messiah who fulfilled the obligations of the ifs so that we could receive the rewards of the thens. The Messiah who has come to make all sad and bad things completely untrue. The Messiah didn't show up in order for us to have a holiday. The Messiah didn't show up for us to have stockings and presents and nice music and traditions or to even merely be admired. The Messiah showed up in order to shut down sin and Satan, death, and our guilt. The Messiah showed up in order to eternally redeem your damned life, restoring you back into friendship with God Almighty, presenting you perfectly to his Father. He came to give you life and life more abundantly, eternally, a perfect life. Anything less is far too less. And this is why we celebrate Jesus. This is why we must celebrate Christmas every day and every season. Don't leave Jesus, the child in the manger. See him on forward on the cross. See him later on the throne as ruling and reigning king. As Charles Wesley wrote in 1739, 280 years ago, "Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings. Risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by. Born that man no more may die." That's part of why he was born. Born to raise the sons of earth. Born to give them second birth. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to this newborn king. Friends, this is the Messiah. His name is Jesus, the King, the promised one, the Christ, the long-awaited one. We celebrate this time of year. We acknowledge the fact of what took place more than 2,000 years ago in the Middle East. In the midst of more than 400 years of silence from God's prophets, the time in between Malachi and the birth of Jesus, the King, in the midst of the most of those spiritual wanderings in the wilderness, living a hopeless, perpetual Egypt, God made good on his promises of hundreds of years of promises by sending the Messiah to earth. He did it. Galatians speaks of this, but when the fullness of time had come, when it was the right time, when it was ready, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those. Remember, we're in captivity? To redeem those who were under the law so that we might receive adoption as sons and daughters. And because you're sons and daughters, God has sent the Spirit of his son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father, so that you're no longer a slave to Egypt or the wilderness, to sin or to death, but a son. And if a son, then you are an heir through God. Adopted by God through faith is the finished work of Jesus the Messiah. This isn't fantasy. This is fact. It's not hoax. It's our hope. And it's the only place where we can find true and lasting eternal hope. And hope doesn't come to us merely because the Messiah showed up, but because of what he accomplished when he did show up. If it was just to die, he would have died with the slaughtering of all children when he was born under the reign of cruel Herod. But what he does is he lives a full life, a complete obedience, a life of perfection. And he lived that life as your representative before God on your behalf. Therefore, God does not see your life of sin. Rather, he sees Christ's life of righteousness. Oh, how important it is to believe this. You see, our previous representative was Adam from the garden. But Jesus, the Messiah, is our better and more perfect representative, or the second Adam, as 1 Corinthians 15 talks of him, or the last Adam, as Paul says. And through faith in Jesus, the Messiah, the Christ, our previous representative Adam is displaced and replaced by our new and better representative, Jesus. Going back to Hark the Herald Angels Sing, Charles Wesley, the last verse of that tremendous Christmas song, he says this: Adam's likeness, Lord, efface, stamp thy image in its place. Second Adam from above, reinstate us in thy love. This reinstating is known as our adoption back into God's family. Now, not only did the Messiah live for us as our representative, but he died for us in our place. He was condemned for us. Jesus, the Messiah, took upon himself the wrath of God that our sin has invited. He died in our place as our wrath-absorbing substitute. Therefore, there is no more wrath, there's no more judgment to fear. He took care of all of this for us, as us. Your sin has been carried by Jesus, the Messiah. Your sin has been taken care of completely by Jesus, the Messiah. Your sin was punished by God through Jesus, the Messiah, taking your place. And here's where this good news gets better. Through your confession of your sin against God, through your belief and your faith in Jesus being your Savior, born for you, dying for you, beating death for you, you are forgiven and you are reconciled back with God. Now, all who look upon Jesus, the Messiah, by faith are given a new identity. They've been adopted. They know that they are cherished. They hear from Scripture that they are now righteous, that they are above reproach, that they are blameless, that they are my people, God says, my delight, God says, my children, God says, no longer enemy, no longer one at hostility with God, one who is family with God. And now, those who've been saved by this magnificent grace of God, we get to live with this new identity being declared over us every day. We get to live from this identity, not for it. Jesus earned it for us, so we can live from it. We no longer have to live a life of fear. We live knowing that Jesus fulfilled all that was required for us to be at peace with God. And now, in our time of need, we can boldly approach the throne of grace, and this is so wonderful. It is a complete joy and delight to preach the good news, to share with you this gospel hug this morning on this Advent week 4. I'm so glad I don't have to get up here and say, you've got to do this and you've got to do that. Instead, I get the privilege of saying, Jesus has done all this. Jesus has done all that. Just believe it. This is the good news of the gospel. We have a wonderful Messiah. We should be so very glad that he showed up. Today, I know that many of us, going back to this narrative of Egypt and wilderness and prophets and Messiah, many of us are living in sin. We're still living as spiritually dead men and women. To echo the words of Scripture, you are still without hope. You are still living in Egypt, as it were. You've been, I believe it was Pastor Brooks that said this, you've been made for Eden, but you're still waking up in Egypt. You've been made for a new kingdom, but you're still waking up in captivity. You're still a slave to the ruthless and abusive masters of sin and death. No lasting peace, no lasting rest, no lasting relief. Friend, hear this if this is you from Hebrews 7. He, the Messiah, is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through Jesus Christ, since he always, constantly lives to make intercession for them. Hear the great Messiah, Jesus the King, call out to you, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me. I am gentle. I'm not to be feared. I'm gentle. I'm lowly in heart. Friend, you will find rest for your souls. And don't worry, as you take my yoke upon you, it's easy. My burden is light. Friend, he came for you. He came to rescue you. Jesus, the Messiah, says those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. The Son of Man came to seek and to save that which is lost. And he says, I've come that you may have life and have life abundantly. Trust Jesus. Also, I know that many of us here this morning, we've been made alive. We've been rescued from Egypt, and we find ourselves in this wilderness. We often find ourselves drifting from false hope to false hope, temporary spurts of obedience, but nothing lasting, wandering in the wilderness. Friends, pray for God to strengthen you. Abide in Christ. Give yourself, give your time, give your thoughts, surrender yourself to God and his word. He will speak to you. He will guide you through the wilderness, a voice calling out in the wilderness. This is the way, wandering in the wilderness, back and forth between what you know that God says and yet listening to yourself. I encourage you, give yourself entirely to him. Trust him fully. No longer be one who is like a wave of the sea that's tossed and driven by the wind. Pray for God to remove the double-mindedness. Pray for him to remove the spiritual instability and even inconsistency, and to give you a single focus for him, a longing for him and his word, giving you stability to navigate the wilderness. As James 1:21 says, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. Receive the word, rehearse the gospel to yourself. And for those who are in this wilderness season right now, I know there's inner turmoil. I know that your passions are raging at war within you. You desire and you don't have, and so you envy and you hate, and you're driven to gain in hopes that you will be satisfied somehow. You covet and you desire, and yet you can't obtain. This is the narrative of the wilderness. be reminded of James 4, but he gives more grace. Ask for this grace. Ask God to experience this grace practically. Ask him to keep you as you wander through the wilderness. Therefore, it says God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. So I encourage you to submit yourselves to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Humble yourselves before the Lord. Humble yourselves before the Lord and he will exalt you. This is the way through the wilderness. And finally, I know that many of us have been made alive. We've been rescued from Egypt. And yes, we're in the midst of the wilderness, but we're trusting God. We're devoted to his word as we're navigating life, as we're waiting for the return of the Messiah, Jesus, the Lord and King. I encourage you from Psalm 37, continue to commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him and he will act. Pray for faith and belief to live this way. Pray for faith to believe this. And as we trust him, believing and hoping in the Messiah's work for us and as us, we're given this meaning and this purpose and this peace and this joy, and we're living in it. And it creates such an eager anticipation to be with him. I remember being with my great-grandma a few years back. She passed away at 108, and she was 105, and she was talking to me. She's like, Jeremy, I've sung songs for so long. I've been a Christian for so many years. I'm just ready to see Jesus. I just want to be with him. As we continue to persevere, embracing the gospel, rehearsing it, giving ourselves fully to Scripture, there will become this longing. Not only when you're 105, but now, in your 20s and 30s, there'll be this longing to be with Jesus. Like Peter says in 2 Peter 3, we are waiting. We're not distracted. We know what we're waiting for. We're waiting according to his promise for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. That is home. And we long for this. We waited and God sent his son the first time. And now today we wait with our eyes to the skies, longing for his return. Be encouraged by the last two verses of the Bible. The Messiah tells us, surely I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with all. Amen. As we wait, we do so looking back, remembering the faithfulness of God, sending his son, the Messiah Jesus, to save us. We focus and we dwell on this fact each week by sharing from the Lord's table. Through communion. What we have heard this morning can be uniquely experienced and remembered now as we share communion together as a church family and before God. So I encourage you to rehearse some of the truth that you heard this morning. Focus on the purpose of the Messiah. Align your heart with the gospel of Christ as you come and you take, as you remember the finished work of Jesus Christ. And follow those two thoughts of representative and substitute. As you take the bread, be reminded of his perfect life, his body lived perfectly for you, broken for you as your representative. Him dying, receiving what you deserve, receiving the punishment that you deserve as he died in your place, this being represented by the blood that he shed, the wine or the juice that's for you this morning. So as you come and you take this bread, representative, dip it into the juice or the wine, substitute. Friend, this morning you cherish the work of the Messiah. You remember the work of the Messiah. For God's sake and his sweet mercy, please do not take this time for granted. Focus on the gospel of Christ, the Messiah given for us. Remember him as you take this morning. Let me pray for us. Father, thank you, Lord, for this hope that we have in you. Thank you for the work that you've accomplished for us through your Son. And Spirit, thank you for coming to us in the Spirit, the Son in the flesh, the Spirit through the Spirit to us, making us alive to these things. Lord, give us faith. Be with our unbelief. Be with us now as we remember. Add your special blessing to this time of remembering through communion. In Christ's name, amen.